Welcome, everybody. It's November 6, 2020. Welcome to Music Cities Together Live. It's been quite a week. It's been quite a year. It's been quite a couple of years. This is an interview show, conversation show about the intersection of music and policy and how we're navigating very complicated times. And I could think of no better way to start this with a little bit of music. So it is my sincere honor to bring into the program from Seattle, Daniel Pak. Daniel.
Oh, pirates, yes, they're rabbi. Sold I to the merchant ships, minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit. But my head was made strong by the end of the Almighty. We forward in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help to sing this songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption. Sing redemption. Redemption. Emancipate yourself from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Ooh, some say it's just a part of it. We got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing their songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption. Sing redemption. Redemption.
Those of you just joining in, once again, my name is Daniel Pak. I'm right here in Seattle, Washington, standing with all of you in solidarity. I'm originally from the island of Oahu in Hawaii. My family's been there for over 100 years. When I was 13 years old, I used to take my guitar down to Kaneohe Bay, and I used to sing this song over and over again, staring out at the military base that took over the entire peninsula right by my home. Every time a fighter jet or a helicopter would buzz over, I'd sing louder and louder. This song means everything to me. It means freedom. It means liberation. It means resistance, resilience. Just remembering, like my Uncle Jacob said, he's an old family friend of Bob Marley. He always used to tell me, Daniel, no matter what, you always got to keep it in the positive. So that's what I encourage you all to do. Much love and aloha.
Emancipate yourself from mental slavery. Learn about
ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophet while we stand aside and look? Yes, some say it's just a part of it. We got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing? These songs of freedom, 'cause all I ever had, redemption. Sing redemption. Sing redemption songs. Whoa, whoa.
Thanks for coming, everybody. That was a great show. We'll see you next week for another edition of Music City Together Live. Daniel, thank you so much. Alex, our producer, is going to put some links into the chat. We had an interview again with Daniel a couple weeks ago about the amazing work that he's doing with Totem Star out in Seattle. Also the work with Keep Washington Music Live or Alive campaign that's going on. Out of appreciation for that beautiful performance, I'd encourage everybody to hit those websites and throw a couple of dollars our way just to say thank you as a small gesture of appreciation if we can. But Daniel, thank you, our friend. We will see you soon.
Thank you so much, Michael.
Yep.
Everybody, love and aloha to you all.
Cheers, cheers, cheers. So Thomas Frank, let's follow that, huh?
Michael Bracy.
Oh my
Very
God.
Very nice to see you.
It's good to see you. It's good to see everybody. We've got a pretty spectacular group of guests today. And we're going to, you know, just kind of chop it up around the election. So we're going to do this at a couple levels. So one level, we're going to share what we know in terms of what's happening, some sort of insight and analysis about what to anticipate over the next couple of weeks, what's going to be happening around some of the congressional activity and some of the transition activity. And then we're going to, you know, bring in some of our colleagues and friends who work at the intersection of music and policy and activism and just kind of do a temperature check and just kind of share how we're feeling and thinking and kind of where we are today. As always, if you have questions, please throw them in the chat or in the Q&A window. We'll get to as many as we can and onwards. So let's start with Tom Frank. Thomas, most of you probably know as a writer, historian, pundit of sorts. Are you a pundit, Tom?
I'm an ex-pundit. I had to turn in my pundit card a few years ago. Yeah. It got canceled.
Very good. Very good. So you've been, I know, thinking about this election, and we're putting in the chat not only a link to your website, but also your new book, The People Know, A History of Populism. So you've been thinking about a lot of this stuff for a long time, and I know you've been having to sort of process your take on you know what we've seen over the last couple of days. Where are you? Like, kind of, what are you thinking this morning or this afternoon?
Well, it's you know what is amusing to me, Michael, is how the stuff that I used to say 10, 15 years ago that was considered so radical and outrageous, it's like Tom Friedman is saying it now. You know, there's it's all over the place now. So I don't know how much, you know, I don't know if anything I'm going to say is even original or startling anymore. One of the things I've been saying ever since Trump first got elected is that that this situation is only going to worsen in this country. And the reason I say that, that I've been saying it for so long, and I know this sounds silly because I'm looking so far into the future, but that's, historians are allowed to do that. The reason I say that is because Trumpism is not going to go away all by itself. This is what I've been saying ever since the guy got elected and, you know, all the sort of craziness began, because I see Trumpism as not a new phenomenon, but a slightly altered version of an old phenomenon, you know, something that you and I have known about for many. Well, if you're as old as me and Michael, this is Reaganism, what, you know, rewarm. This is Nixonism, slightly heated up. You know, Trump was this huge admirer of Nixon, stole his campaign slogan from Trump. And the guy who he probably stole most from was Pat Buchanan, who was out with a big essay today. I don't know if you saw. I mean, why would you? You don't follow Pat Buchanan. Pat Buchanan is crowing. He is overjoyed. He is so pleased. I think the title of his essay, let me pull it up here. I was just reading it before we started. That's why I was late. I was reading essay by Pat Buchanan. Trumpism lives on. And yeah, here's the thing. Trumpism, this kind of crazy fake populism with all of its vulgarity and its stupidity and all the rest of it. I always said this is Trump is in some ways a remarkable leader, because you know he said what he did about trade agreements, and he said what he did about endless wars and stuff like that. But Trump was also a terrible, I mean, just in political terms, this guy's one of the worst politicians. In practical terms, worst politicians you and I have ever seen. You know, he can't shut up. The stupid stuff that he tweets, insulting people needlessly, offending members of his own administration, like these loyalists, they all leave the White House in tears and write a memoir, you know, talking about what a jerk he is. This guy is utterly incompetent, just in a straight up political sense. And so I've always said Trumpism is not going anywhere. And the next Trump is going to be, anyhow, fast forward, here we are. And you saw these fascinating results, things that I never thought I would see with the Latino voters going his way in parts of Florida and parts of Texas. And this really bodes poorly for the future. For the future of, you know, our country. This is going to be back in a couple of years. I think here's what we're heading into. We've got Biden is a weak, Joe Biden's going to be president, obviously. Joe Biden's at this stage in his life, is a weak personality. I used to kind of admire him, you know, not all that long ago, but now I watch him speak and I'm like, you know, this is really, this is sad is what it is. And he's going to be weakened further still by not having the Senate and just a small majority in the House. It's going to be tough for him to get anything really momentous done. It was going to be tough to begin with because of the kind of guy he is and who's advising him, et cetera. It's going to be much tougher. And what I've said for, you know me, Michael, what I've said for decades, what needs to happen with the Democratic Party is a complete sort of rethink of where they are and what the direction that they've been traveling in since the 1970s. And I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon. I think Biden is like capable of doing something like that, but I don't think it's going to happen anytime soon. And so I have great trepidation. What's funny is Wall Street loves where we are. They love the idea that you're going to have this sort of hapless Democrat in the White House who doesn't have a mandate and doesn't have a majority. They love this. They love government that does nothing. Anyhow, so that's what I think of the future of Trumpism, the Democrats, and I don't know.
Yeah, so you see why we started the show with Daniel and not with Tom. So the I think the...
Oh, come on now. You want me to sing a song? Come on. I can't beat that. That's like, I can't sing.
So let's take a sunnier side. And I should have started this by saying again, you know, for those watching the archive, we're recording this at, you know, 2 o'clock Eastern time on Friday. It looks Biden is on track for 306 electoral votes, most likely. We're all sort of waiting for Pennsylvania, Nevada, Arizona to be called. Georgia looks like it's going to go to a runoff. Nobody thinks that North Carolina is going to flip, but hypothetically, it could maybe possibly if there's like a bazillion.
You drop at the Senate now.
No, I'm talking about, and just in terms of the presidential. So we're anticipating, the call at some point this afternoon or evening. Yeah. And then they
better do it. You know, I've got a story in with my publisher, The Guardian, you know, this British newspaper that I wrote, I don't know, I shouldn't tell you this, like 5 days ago.
Don't say that.
And they're waiting for the AP to, you know.
Here's the mental sort of exercise, you know, I've been doing this week. And I'm not saying this to be a devil's advocate. I'm just, you know, saying this because you and I have a little bit different viewpoints of the world in general. And, you know, my feeling is if you told me on Monday, day before the election, that again, Biden would win. It looks like he's going to wind up winning by about 5%, that we would have record turnout. So more people voted for Biden than anybody in history, that we would flip Georgia, that we would flip Arizona, that we would make progress in Texas. And again, I should have said, again, I apologize. Our program is, we don't tend to delve so much in politics and certainly mean to be partisan and we don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. We don't share the politics that are being expressed in today's program. We still want you in this community and we'll talk more about why it's important for policy and music policy to be nonpartisan and bipartisan. Sorry, that out of the way. Me personally, my personal politics.
I spent election day with two Trump supporters.
yeah.
Family members.
Yeah, no, I and we all have them and we love them. You know, so I think that, you know, most realistic, you know, when you get beyond sort of like the structural, you know, the potential that the bottom would fall out like in 1980 or that, you know, that somehow, you know, things would magically, you know, congeal. And instead of it being, you know, an 5 to 8 point win, it would be an 8 to 15 point win. And that, you know, I don't know how realistic that was. I don't know how many, you know, if people really anticipated, you know, going into this week that it's going to be that scale. But, you know, I mean, there's a lot to take away to say this was a pretty good beating at the presidential level. You know, the real problems, again, as you said, are the Senate and the House, you know, both of which really underperformed.
I think that's, yeah, I mean, you might be right. It's what is annoying is that it's. I mean, this has been an annoying last couple of days in every respect. And if there was any sense of a mandate for Biden, it's lost now. Just in the last couple of days, this is nothing like 2008. You remember when that's sort of the last time anybody had a mandate
I'm gonna
like that.
Push, so I hear you, and I just what I'm frustrated by is how much of that is just manufactured because of Pennsylvania's. The Republican legislature's decision to count votes the way they counted votes, which was a very cynical play to set up this dynamic where the whole election would be in question.
Yeah, well, that should this be, was I a, mean, is that even going to matter? They're not even going to matter in the end.
Probably have a call by midnight on Tuesday, and there is a mandate, or there's a different dynamic.
I don't even think Pennsylvania is going to make the, don't you think it's going to, if Arizona flips here in the next couple of hours, that's it. Yeah, Pennsylvania won't matter.
I mean, the point is, I'm just, when you think about a mandate, these are psychological things.
Yeah.
And so the fact that this is the second largest victory since 2000, you know, I mean, it's this in 2008. So, you know, we think about a lot of people claiming a mandate when this is actually more sizable on many levels. But I think just your point is the psychology around it. So for the music side, this really is complicated.
Hey, wait a second. Don't change the subject yet. So the... Trump's speaking of music,
I know.
I'm sorry. I thought you were asking. Okay. All right.
Go. No, go ahead.
Talking about live performances. One of the things that really struck me in the last week before the, before election day was Trump's rallies that he was going around the country. He did it with Hillary as well. Do you remember this? He was doing 4 or 5 a day. In the middle of a pandemic, you know, and this is a guy that had COVID. And it was so bizarre, you know, watching this. And I'm not just talking about it being irresponsible, which of course it was, but also this demonstration of strength and of traditional, you know, sort of traditional retail politics, but also of sort of COVID defiance. But doing this when Biden is not responding in any way or holding these, you know, the drive-in rallies. And do you remember, and this really impressed me in 16 also, when Hillary was like barely doing anything in the days leading up to the election day. And I wonder how much that mattered. Now, maybe it didn't matter at all, but anyhow, it's just something that...
I'm actually glad you raised it. And this is actually a good time to kind of bring Dean into the conversation, because what we've seen this year in across the music community, and especially in people who participate in the work that we represent in today's program, was a very firm commitment to the health of audiences, to the health of musicians, to trying to respond to the crisis by looking at the science, by making the sacrifices necessary, and getting to a point where we can restart and reopen music as quickly and as safely as possible, but doing it, you know, from a level of being responsible. And, you know, clearly it's been a shock to the system, you know, to see what happened after Memorial Day, right? I mean, there was a lot of hope that this was going to be something that by Labor Day, we were kind of getting back to normalish a little bit or some version of normal. To see what happened after Memorial Day and the second wave was awful. But then to see this sort of, you know, parade of irresponsibility, you know, I mean, this has been like Sturgis on steroids for the last 3 weeks. And to see all the things that we can't do, that the music community is not allowed to do, we're not allowing ourselves to do, being flaunted, you know. And yesterday, 120,000 cases. And so the twinning here, to get back to your point, Tom, about how awful the politician he was, is, I don't know what tense I have to use now, but this has direct and dire consequences for the community, not only around, again, getting ourselves with this disease to a point where we can get back to the next normal, whatever that's going to look like, but also very directly around the relief funding. So his complete hackery around trying to get a stimulus package done before the election, which Congress wants to include money through the Save Our Stages bill, which would be up to $10 billion to put an injection of cash to help, you know, the independent venue community get to a reopening spot. The fact that he bungled those politics so badly, because he literally doesn't know how to do politics. But then on top of it, you know, it's just now so exacerbated by, again, the growth of the virus, the fact that now we're looking at months, you know, before we get a handle on it, because I don't think he's making a deal with Biden next week to put Fauci in charge and like rein this in December. You know, it's really uncertain. And so we're now, and actually, let me go ahead and welcome Dena Morris. Dena is the co-lead of our Seattle REVS pilot, has extensive experience in Washington, both as a Senate aide and working at the CDC. And, you know, so we're moving into this very complicated situation where Mitch McConnell appears to be in control. He is in control of the Senate now. It appears likely that he will be in control of the Senate as majority leader. Next year, we're going to talk a little bit about the dynamics of what's happening in Georgia, which could upset that apple cart. But now you basically have a weakened Speaker Pelosi and a weakened House Democratic Caucus. You have a president who was calling for stimulus and then calling for no stimulus and again calling for massive stimulus. Again, nobody knows anything about what this guy's going to do, but the assumption is that he's not going to want to be excited about putting stimulus money out on his watch and adding to the federal debt on his way out the door. And then McConnell, who I think the assumption is, and Dena, we haven't had a chance to talk about this, but the assumption is that he would probably support just very, very targeted, very limited, maybe some state and local funding, maybe some liability protections, maybe extension of PPP or some unemployment, but not the kind of scale of a $2 trillion bill, probably much more around like a $600 or $700 million bill. So, and then that's where Save Our Stages and all the sort of relief, you know, potential is sort of caught in that mix. So Dena, could you just talk a little bit about, I mean, so first of all, thank you and how are you? And you're muted.
Okay, there we go. Hello and thank you. And thank you to Daniel. That was amazing. What a beautiful way to open the conversation. I really appreciate you teeing that up. Hi, Tom.
Dena, what up?
Good job laying the stage here.
So, I mean, Dena, you look at this situation with Save Our Stages and the potential relief legislation. I mean, what's your head at this morning? I mean, what do you?
Well, thanks for asking. I mean, you know, Tom was pretty bleak about where we are, and I was hoping I could come in and say something more positive, but there's really not a lot of positive to say. I mean, this is the first time in decades that a new president has come into office without control of both chambers. And if we had to pick a chamber, I would rather he have control of the Senate, because it can affect everything from confirming cabinet choices to, again, the judiciary sort of conveyor belt that we've seen over the last couple of years. But also this whole idea that you can do nothing. You know, Tom said something about Wall Street loves this setup because nothing's going to happen. and that's kind of where we are. It's going to be really hard. McConnell is notoriously difficult to deal with. He's also looking ahead at the next election cycle and, you know, his own Republican seats that are going to be up. And so he's going to be as careful as he can be. And I do think that it bodes very poorly for our ability. You know, you articulated this really well, Michael. We are watching our music venues struggle, thinking, okay, maybe we can hold on for 4 months. Okay, maybe we can hold on for 8 months. But I don't know, a year and a half, how many venues are we gonna have left? And we were really counting on the federal government coming through. And I think the current reality as it looks, and things could still change, I get that, but it's not very promising. And so there's a possibility, you know, we have strong champions, there's always a possibility, anything is possible. And certainly in this current political environment, I think it's hard to make solid predictions, but I do think that the potential for securing relief and some kind of sustaining funding for our venues has gone down pretty dramatically in the last couple of days.
Yeah, so let's run through a couple things real quick. And again, I hope our audience enjoys this, because this is kind of what our life is, what we talk about all the time. And I know most people don't want this life, so, you know, maybe boring for them. But so where we stand as of right now is, it appears, unless something miraculous happens in North Carolina, which again, it doesn't feel like there's 150,000 random votes in North Carolina. That could be, there could be, you know, a tiniest sliver of hope that there could be a change there. The other race, which is in complete random land, is Alaska, which is heavily vote by mail. They're not gonna count the votes that came in by mail until next week for some reason. There is, Alaska is very rarely polled, so there's not a lot of good data. Of course, even if they polled it, there may not have been good data. Who knows if polls work anymore? But there's, again, I'm not suggesting that that's a competitive race. I'm suggesting that that is the only other thing that is in play, except for this anomaly in Georgia. So let's talk about what's going to happen in Georgia. So basically, they under their state rules, two things happened that were unusual. So under the state rules, if a candidate is held below 50%, they go to a runoff statewide, just a one-on-one runoff. The second thing is they had a special election because of retirement of a sitting senator. So they had a special election. So you have two Senate elections this year that are both going to run off on January 5th. And actually, we're going to have a little cameo here real quick. Burtis Downs is popping in from Athens, Georgia. Burtis, are you with us? There he is.
Yeah, I am. Hi.
So are you ready for us all to come down to Georgia for a couple of weeks?
8.5 weeks. But, you know, I would recommend driving. So you might want to start soon if you live as far away as all y'all do. But yeah, I mean, I think it'd be great. I'm in Athens, where I've been since I came here to go to law school in 1978. And I will first say to Tom, Frank, longtime reader, honored to be on the same Zoom with you. And but I was also, when I figured out what your shirt said, where is Olathe? Or how do you say it?
It's Olathe. It's a suburb of Kansas City.
Okay, so it is in Kansas. Okay, I assumed it was in Kansas, all right, cool.
It's the county seat of Johnson County, Kansas.
All right. But it's also a college. It's the college.
Focus, you guys. My Lord, what is happening? Everybody's punchy today. All right, Bertis, we have two Senate races. Tell us real quick. Tell us about the candidates. Tell us what we should be excited by. And just, do you have any confidence? And if you have confidence, why would you have any either hope that the Democrats could potentially compete in those races?
Well, first, I'd like to, first of all, Michael, don't change the subject so fast. I would like to suggest, I've got a book recommendation for Tom Frank's next book. What's Going On in Georgia? Might be a good
text.
If you're going to be here 8 weeks anyway, you know, feel free to write some notes down. No, I think in both Senate races, we have a chance. They're both really hard. Georgia has this weird rule, and we were all pulling really hard for it the other day, that if you don't get 50% plus one vote, you go to a runoff. Obviously, the presidential election doesn't have that rule. You can win with a plurality. And if there's a bunch of, you know, Ross Perot's in the race, Clinton can still win. But in Georgia, if there's a Shane Hazel in the race, who's the Libertarian, who takes a little over 1% of the vote, and neck are Perdue and Ossoff, then it goes to a runoff. And so that's set for a runoff. We have a 33-year-old kind of upstart, you know, the guy's 10 years out of college, real smart, young, charismatic candidate named John Ossoff. He's somewhere between a liberal and a moderate, depending on how you define that, and what, you know, what time of the cycle it is. He has attracted a lot of money nationally, and he put it to good use. And then in the second race, it's I think the last time there were two U.S. senators elected from a state the same day, whereas California with Feinstein and Boxer, but I could be wrong on that. But if somebody told me that like 30 years ago, that happened. So the reason is because Johnny Isakson ran for re-election 2 years ago, promptly resigned because of his Parkinson's, so that Brian Kemp, the newly elected governor, was able to appoint Kelly Loeffler. He took a bunch of applications. He appointed Kelly Loeffler. She's been a very, very effective Trump senator. And she and Perdue both are among the people who, I'm not being partisan here, I'm just stating facts. But Loeffler and Perdue both had quite a few questions asked about their stock portfolio right in the wake of the February disclosures about COVID in private meetings and actually on the record conversations, followed by some sales of their vast wealth. They're both very rich people. So they're facing these young upstarts, both on the Democratic side. Ossoff, who's 33, I don't exactly know Raphael Warnock's age, but he's in his late 40s, maybe mid 40s. He's been the pastor at Ebenezer Baptist Church for about a dozen years. He's been there a while. He's a senior minister there, very well respected. He conducted John Lewis's funeral on national TV. What was it 2 months ago? So that's the dynamic. And yeah, we have a chance, but you know, Georgia's still very much a red state. I don't know how it worked out. I think that a lot of people who didn't vote for Trump, maybe I have a few friends that are kind of conservative, center-right type people, and they generally vote for Republicans, but they're decent enough people, and they're not stupid. And they don't fit the Trump base. So they didn't vote for Trump, but I think they still went ahead and voted for their regular senator. They didn't really have a problem with Loeffler or Perdue.
Yeah.
So anyway, we've got a chance, but it's a fighting chance. I mean, we got a puncher's chance. And if we have the right turnout and we have the right combination, if there's enough excitement and coordination, and that is the key to what happened in Georgia. The reason I think we pulled it off here, which it looks really weird, if it holds that red state right in the middle of the deep South between Virginia and New Mexico, I think in that sweep, that's the only red state there is. I think it happened for one reason, which is quite a few years ago, a small group of people here in Georgia started something trying to model itself on these donor alliances, like happen right now in Colorado and are happening right now in North Carolina. I mean, those are the ones we were kind of aware of, but there are now about 30 of them in different states, including some pretty red states like Georgia. And we find that getting people to work together and coordinating through, it's not central planning, it's not a top-down type thing, but it is something that everybody knows what everybody's doing. And you have a combination of C3s and C4s and PACs, and you try to all essentially coordinate so that people do the things they're good at, but you're aware of what allied partners are doing as well. I'll be quiet now. And that's essentially what's happening in Georgia. I'm sure there are ways to help out. I'm not sure sending tons of money is the thing that's necessary. That didn't seem to work a lot of places. But to the extent you have any influence with people in Georgia or have media access in Georgia or, have musical connections and helping convince people, helping persuade people that taking a chance on these young, upstanding, rising stars in the other party, if you're a Republican, might be worth a chance here, given the quality of the candidates on the Republican incumbent side.
Well, Bertus, that's so helpful. And I just say this, I mean, assuming that the vote turns out the way it looks like it is and that Biden wins, the idea that Joe Biden, of all people, would be the first Democrat since 1992 to win Georgia and beat Donald Trump, who brought out historic levels of votes, makes me feel, again, like I don't see any reason with Trump not on the ballot that these two candidates can't compete. And Dena, just to bring it back to you real quick, and then I want to bring in Martine and Erin, but can you just quickly help explain what is the difference between a 50-50 Senate and a 52-48 Republican lead? Like, what happens if there's a 50-50 Senate for the entire goals of the Biden administration?
Yeah, if we got to a 50-50 Senate, we could start legislating. We could actually make some things happen. We could spend some money. We could enact some probably not wildly progressive agenda items, but we could certainly begin to turn the tide on climate and equity and racial justice and all of the things that we're so far behind on. With a 50-50 Senate, the Democratic Party under a Democratic president can actually do things. And if we get into a tie, the vice president comes in and makes the tie-breaking vote. And so that makes all the difference. And in our current Senate, under current rules and under Leader McConnell, we still abide by the 60-vote filibuster rule, which, to be super brief about it, just means one person can stop anything from happening, essentially. So anyway, there's a lot more I can say about all of that, but I want to hear from some of the other people too. It's all the difference. If we were able to pick up those two Georgia seats, it would make all the difference in what happens over the next 4 years.
And I think just to amplify that, Dena, it also is who Biden can put in the cabinet, right? I mean, so it's cabinet appointees, it's the whole shooting match. So again, I mean, it may be a tall order. We don't know. It's going to take some time to kind of figure out everything. But January 5th, Georgia runoffs, I mean, that is, that's going to be a lot. So thank you guys. On the politics, I want to bring in Martine and Erin, who everybody who's watching this program is very familiar with their work. We're going to put links to Bandcamp pages. Today's Bandcamp Friday. Yay, Bandcamp, again, sharing their portions of their revenues with artists on Fridays. You guys have both had work that you came out with this year. You know, we had you on previous shows, and Alex is going to put the links in the chat if you want to hear other interviews with you from earlier in the year, just in terms of more broadly how you're navigating the pandemic. Martine, you've had some major life changes in your life as well on top of that. Why don't we just kind of open up, how are you guys feeling today? And all of this stuff we've been talking about, how does this land with you all?
Erin, do you want to go first?
Okay, Poppy. Congratulations, Martine and Courtney.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. It's really nice to see everyone. I feel like I'm at a barbecue in Bracy's backyard. I think we have had this exact crew at that before. So thank you for the invitation. I'll try to keep it brief. I feel great. I think the Trump voter dies off. I mean, we're in a tough position right here. But if you look at those maps of like the age of what the Electoral College would be if people under a certain age vote I think in the long game, those people die, personally. I don't think they can be reached. I don't think the Democratic Party should try to find them. I think we continue to move progressively, and I think we continue to commit to a progressive agenda and slow going in the meantime. And in the long game, I think they die. that's my optimism. And, I worked for the census this summer, and I was a door-to-door enumerator for the census. And I honestly think it's one of the most important things I've ever done. And it really, I'd do it again in a heartbeat. And And I think door knocking is possible in the pandemic. I think community is possible in the pandemic. We did it safely. And I had some amazing, I live in Western Massachusetts and it is not uniform. There are a lot of people here that feel a lot of different ways. And I had a lot of really interesting conversations, tense sometimes, uncomfortable sometimes. But nothing has made me feel more hopeful or possible or energized about just being part of things than doing something like that. So, you know, I did see something on Twitter the other day about how Democrats stopped door knocking and Republicans didn't. And I just want to say that they're, you know, don't stop door knocking. It can be done safely, I think. What else can I say? Yeah, that's it. I think I feel good. I'm looking forward to those people dying out like the dinosaurs.
Martine, where's your head this morning?
I'm cautiously optimistic. I became a father 11 days ago, so that's been occupying most of my time. Very happy about that.
Did you hear that there was an election, Martine?
Yeah, that's what they tell me. I'm in California now. I was in Pennsylvania up until last year. And to the door knocking piece, it's important, but it also depends on what you look like, because me and my wife both were out and about in the community. And not everybody is happy to see a face that doesn't look like theirs, that even remotely, even if it's a different haircut, if the tone is the same, I think that's what scares me right now, is that people are kind of burrowing into, particularly people who need more diversity, and to realize that America is this multicultural place. They're digging further and further into their echo chambers. And what's scary is that every time there's a summer and there's summer festivals and music happening outdoors, that creates a whole bunch of safe spaces for people that are like, oh, this person looks different than me, and they don't bite, you know? Mm. And that didn't happen this year. So I feel like this, like all of those things, music, live music not happening, missing a whole summer of just people being outdoors and looking and seeing and enjoying and sharing these positive experiences together, put us in a much more nasty place. Mm-hmm. It's frustrating too, because all of the different positive messages that musicians can share on stage that were helping us get through the first 3 years of the Trump presidency, we've largely been unable to deliver those and create those spaces of, you know, healing or just recharging the batteries. So people on one hand are in need of live music more than ever. And I don't think we're any closer to reestablishing stuff than we were in March or April. Just as, you know, insofar as my group Antibalas is concerned, this is an album cycle for us. We released a new record on Daptone back in, was it February?
February.
Started off our tour, one of our best tours ever, you know, year 21, 22, depending on where you start counting, of the group. And had a whole European tour as well booked. And in March, everything got pushed back initially to this fall. And then this fall stuff got pushed to May. And our first stuff is not until, it's like London in May. And who knows, you know, that's just a pin in the calendar. So it is really scary. I mean, no musician is going to like put their instrument away and never pull it out again. But the live music industry was always so precarious, you know, particularly for people in large groups. Over the years, you know, as the value of recorded music dropped, we have to go and claim more of our income by being out on the road and performing live. And that means taking on an immense amount of risk. There's no guarantee, even if you get guarantees, the club is going to pay you X thousand dollars when you show up. There's all these bad things that cost money between this stop and the club. So it was already very precarious. It's heartbreaking to see venues, you know, a lot of the, and ironically, it's most of the good venues that are closing. It's like, there's some bad venues too that were not worth playing, but I see more good venues struggling, closing, more consolidation of venues by larger entertainment companies that have deeper pockets and money to sort of play with and take, you know, we're going to see some disaster capitalism in the venue world. And venues, you know, who have spent 20, 30 years establishing a brand. Well, the brand is not going to go away, but it's going to be a front for Live Nation or some of these other bigger players. And it'll just be literally a shell of what it was. I remember, you know, when Bonnaroo was sold and playing at the old Bonnaroo and the new Bonnaroo. And it was garbage. Like when, I forget who bought it, but I was there the last time I was there with Angelique Kidjo, you know, multiple time Grammy winner, global cultural ambassador. And we didn't have a dressing room and we were standing outside in the hot sun, like right by this diesel generator, waiting to go on stage where U2 was in the front row watching us. And we couldn't get meals, you know? That was how Bonnaroo treated it. I feel like musicians, we can expect further shitty treatment because there's going to be a lot of people who are like, you should be lucky that you have a stage to play on, you know? I'm excited about being a father. I'm making music. I'm creative. But this whole thing has been such a shit show. Can I say shit on the internet? You know, even if you like Trump, like COVID-19, if this was played right, this would have been America's chance to reassert its power globally as a moral power, as a health power, as a military power. This could have been, you know, I don't like the idea of America as an empire, but a smarter, wilier president could have used this to reestablish global American hegemony. And they didn't. Not only did they not do that, but the country is falling apart at the seams because of it. So it's good. I think it ultimately is a good thing if Biden can win, but that doesn't mean, it doesn't materially mean anything. It just means that we can breathe, you know, have a sigh of relief, you know, because it wasn't like Donald Trump shut down music venues. He just made it, you know, there was less, people weren't even thinking about culture has value. It did make it hard for us to travel internationally, where about half of our shows are. Because either it wasn't like we were refused entry at the border, but now we are, you know, like even if other countries were to reopen and say, hey, Antibalas, we want you to come play here. We can't necessarily get in, you know, yeah. Like the value as international musicians, the value of our passport has gone from one of the most valuable in the world to one of the least valuable in the world. To the point I've never thought I would say, like, getting a Jamaican passport would be like a much, you know, a very valuable card to have. But it is. You know, culture is going to keep on happening. But I think it's really uncertain right now. After 6 months of us Zooming and trying to do Zoom concerts, that is definitely geared for the singer-songwriter individual musician, who some of people have made incredible use out of it. But as a band, particularly if not everybody lives in the same city, like it's just like health-wise, we can't get into the same room and play and sing. Like that just can't happen without getting vaccinated first. You know, we have 5 wind instruments and everybody sings. We just can't do it. So we've been, you know, everybody's survival strategy has been different, you know, and everybody who applied to the unemployment in New York, like, has a completely different story. So there hasn't been really any uniformity as far as how musicians have been surviving.
I really appreciate what both of you are saying at such a high level. And I want to welcome back, you know, into this conversation, Dena and Tom and actually Burtis, if you all have other things you want to contribute along with Erin and Martine. I mean, I think, you know, this year's been fascinating for so many reasons, because again, you know, we've been in crisis mode, you know, and triage mode. And so, you know, part of our brains, our collective brains have been in, how do we just get through this year, right? And how do we get through tomorrow? And how do we support each other? And what is our economic situation? What is our health situation? What is our mental health situation? So you've got, you know, kind of triage mode. But then we've also had, I think, in the music community, certainly what we've seen, you know, through our networks at Music Policy Forum and through the REVS initiative, is this, you know, kind of parallel reckoning that it's not enough to just quote unquote restart the music industry. We have to reimagine the music industry, that there's this deep alignment, you know, and sort of the structural, you know, injustices that are sort of baked into the economics of this community that we need to address and need to understand how do we do that either through industry reform or through policy reform or through all the different, you know, sort of levers. And, you know, I think about next year and I think about a couple of things, you know, and again, you know, you all know me, people who watch the show, you know, have seen me, so you know me a little bit. I mean, you know, this is just the way I think, you know, which is somewhere between optimistic and Pollyannish. So I know that. But, you know, I think on the health side, we can assume that the next administration is going to hire scientists and they're going to listen to scientists and they're going to be grounded and coordinated. And we're going to get the vaccines moving and we're going to get the protocols together and we're going to get some order on this thing. And I don't know how long it's going to take. And Dena, you've got a lot more expertise around those issues, but at some point we're going to get through this, which again, if, you know, Trump had won, you know, then you're looking at herd immunity, right? I mean, literally he had no plan, you know, there was no plan. So that I feel like we can have some confidence that at some point in the future, we're going to get ahead of this particular, you know, pandemic. But then I look at the structural issues and the power issues and the sort of, you know, opportunities that we have, not only through things like Save Our Stages. I mean, the idea of $10 billion towards music is pretty transformative. I don't think we'll get $10 billion. Ultimately, we may not get zero, but, you know, billions of dollars going to help support the live music ecosystem is great. You've got the awareness on antitrust issues. You know, a lot of the things that Martine, you're just speaking to have antitrust implications in terms of the structural power, particularly in venues and in promoters. And, you know, we know that the Biden Justice Department is going to be much more vigilant on antitrust, or we can assume that's going to be the case. We don't know that for sure. Or we have a lot more infrastructure to kind of engage in those things. You know, I'm curious about and sort of where our heads are, again, is trying not to repeat what I would suggest was the major mistake, one of the major mistakes of the Obama years, which was a lot of engagement around electing Obama and then a lot of disengagement saying, okay, the job's done, go make things happen. And, you know, the issue for all of us is how do we translate the sort of focus on the election and then how does that translate into actually making structural policy? I know Erin and Martine, I mean, you've both been active in policymaking, you've been on the Hill, you've been at the FCC, you know, you've talked to policymakers on a bunch of stuff. You know, Martine was in the White House in the last administration talking about immigration policy. I mean, you know, so you guys have done that work. I don't know, this is not really, it's more of a speech than a question, but, you know, any thoughts on sort of taking, after we all recharge and get out of this week, you know, getting focused on, again, sort of like where the tangible things that we're doing to make these changes happen, to envision these changes and make them happen?
I just this is more, this is not a speech. It's just a provocation of just saying that I no longer find it interesting, doable, sustainable, or I don't have any reason to wake up at 5 a.m. and drive to Ann Arbor to play a show anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's one example, but I'm not the only person that feels that way. That has been a revelation of the pandemic, is that that is on no level worth it to me or sustainable. And I've already done it 30 times anyway. And that's not me speaking as a 43-year-old. That's me speaking as like, oh, I have this perspective now. And I'm not sure that was ever useful. So the only thing I can offer beyond that is to say that I have felt the thing I want to build on is I did a random poetry reading on the beach for 5 people at my favorite restaurant that's closed because of the pandemic. And it was the most fulfilling thing I've done in a long time. And everyone was really happy to be there. And they traveled less than 5 miles to, you know, and there's something in there for me that tells me like what is next. So yes, of course, it's important to go to DC and do all that stuff. And I'm very grateful for those opportunities and that perspective. But it's too far a plane ride. Mm-hmm. You know, like what's happening next town over? I think that's where my head is at. Mm-hmm. Martine?
I agree with you. The future for me culturally seems, at least for the short, medium term, is local. And to your point, Erin, when we go on tour, the main benefactor of Antibalas touring is United Airlines. Like travel costs are 70% of our overhead.
Gas stations and rest stops. Yeah.
Yeah. It's the oil industry.
Hotels.com. Yeah.
Is the oil industry wins when we go on tour. So like 60 to 70% of our overhead is like travel costs, hotel rooms. And to take, 14 people, 3,000, and then I think about the carbon, how inefficient it is for us to, jump on a plane from different places, fly to some festival in, Washington State or wherever, to play for 60 to 90 minutes and then turn around and go back with $300 to $500 in our pockets, waiting around for the next gig. That makes no sense to me. And the fact that I've had like 9 months of like not having to do that because I can't do it. It feels so liberating to be like, fuck that. Like something, I would rather just do something else musically and culturally than leave my family. The opportunity cost of that is immense right now. And then also to go out on the road and risk getting sick for any, like some amount of money that's not game changing. I would rather just be at home and make less money and sing to my daughter than to do all that stuff. It's just not worth it to me anymore. But I do think that it's going to be local, like smaller, local, outdoors. It's going to take on different forms. And ultimately, that's a positive thing. That people go and see musicians that are from where they're from, rather than being like, nothing's happening here until my favorite national touring act comes through. Like that's not healthy, and it hasn't been healthy. So I the positive I see is local scenes coming up, music happening in places that aren't corporate owned or that don't need to sell drinks in order to survive, house concerts, backyard concerts. It's going to happen, but it's not going to look anything like it did, pre-February.
I just want to also say that the accessibility that has been revealed by what all of us have had to do with the pando, in terms of like stepping up our live streaming situation, dealing with like I have a musical that's licensed to a company and they never had an agreement about live streaming. And now they had to figure it out because we had a bunch of productions that got canceled and those colleges didn't want to cancel the production. They wanted to do a Zoom version of the musical. They wanted to do a hybrid filmed version of the musical. And the unions say no, and the licensing company says no. And so those colleges write to me directly. And then I'm able to go, anyway, long story short, that company now, which has many, many like wonderful theatrical things, has a live streaming situation. Mm-hmm. And we argue they should have had that 15 years ago. But I think those accessibility things are actually also like some part of this future conversation so that like when it is safe, like every show should be live streamed, every show should be captioned, every show should have a tier for people who cannot get to it in person to be able to come virtually. And the technology is not an issue. We already know that. So Dena, I'm sorry. I feel like I keep cutting you off.
No. It's okay. I actually like where you are, taking the conversation much better than where I was going, which was a little bit down again. So let's just stay there.
The other thing that I would love to see with live music is to talk about some kind of an equity rider that different actors in the film industry are doing. Because after 20, 25 years in the music industry, particularly like venues are still mostly dude spaces. From the person who's running the lights to the house sound engineer. It's still very much a guy, like straight guy space, and straight white guy space. Like it's not more ethnically diverse, even though the bands are. And this, this last tour that we did, we had a woman front of house, woman merch, two women on stage, trumpet, tenor sax. And I don't want like, that was sort of like the future of where we were going. And we need to see more venue, like, but it's heartbreaking to go to a venue where it's like, wow, you're still stuck in like 1977. You know, and meanwhile, here we are with a set of different expectations trying to transform the vibe here, and we're still butting up against all these old behaviors. So I'd like to see engaged more musicians in discussions of like, what are these things that we always complain about venues or the industry that need to change, but because we're so busy chasing after the next gig or trying to show up on time and make sure that we sound good, that we've never really had time to pause and change. And now, because everything is on the table, we can discuss that again. You know, if a whole bunch of new venues are going to open or reopen, we actually, as musicians, have some control over, well, how bad do you want us? What have you were messed up the last time we played, you know? There were all these issues, as Erin said, of accessibility, whether it was like bathrooms or it was the vibe or it was too expensive or not ADA accessible, any number of things, or just not healthy for the musicians. We have some leverage, you know, because ultimately there's not going to be some whole new crop. There's going to be some new musicians who get gigs, but people are going to want to see the people that they were seeing before the pandemic too, because people who have established themselves in a live stream, they have some fans, but they haven't proved themselves on stage yet, you know? So there's going to be kind of both of those sets of competition. But ultimately, I see this as a positive moment to get for us to leverage more change within the industry. Now, on the bigger questions of capital and owning venues, that's another story. It's not something that I put my mind to, of like, who's going to be owning the venues that we play. But there's plenty of money in this country. You know, it's like, this is not a poor country. And there's money in live music and money in merch and money in drinks and all that stuff. It's a huge economic driver. So,
well, and I think that. Martine, and we're actually at time, so we're going to have to bring this to a close, or we'll just transition to our own private Zoom, just kidding. But I think the challenge is, like, everything you both are saying are exactly right. And this is what we're hearing consistently from musicians, from people in the industry. It's that, you know, this is an opportunity to really get off the treadmill and rethink and sort of reorient. And I think the challenge is, I would suggest that there's sort of three different levels of challenges, you know, moving forward once, again, we get past the election and clear our brains a little bit. You know, I think one is, certainly I do think, and I've said this every week for, you know, last several months, I mean, I think the Save Our Stages advocacy led by NEVA and supported by many others, you know, is clearly the most successful, you know, kind of organizing campaign on behalf of independent music that I've ever seen in this country, you know, by far. And we need to follow through in the promise of that. And that's getting that bill passed, getting that bill funded, you know, demonstrating that we can organize in a bipartisan way, right? I mean, the bill's led in the Senate by John Cornyn from Texas, you know, and like, you know, understand how policy gets made, fall through in that and try to, you know, get that piece done. And then think about the rest of the federal agenda that's going to set the, you know, sort of parameters of our structure. So again, antitrust enforcement, net neutrality, scaling and rethinking public media, thinking about arts and education, that whole federal agenda that needs to happen. I think at the same time, you know, we're building power locally, you know, in a fairly organic way, again, to challenge ourselves to do better, you know, and to not just to, I think to both of you said this really well. I mean, we don't need to, you know, ideally just play the game the way the game has been played for a long time, you know, and disaster capitalism. I think you're spot on, Martine, you know, when you use that phrase, you know, we can't just fall victim to that. So, you know, really combining, you know, understanding how this next political era has an opportunity to, you know, really, you know, transform the music community, but also understand that we have to collectively as a community articulate what does that mean in practice? What do we want? So anyway, that was a lot. Thomas Frank, thank you for coming and talking music for a while. Dena, Martine, Erin, thank you as always. Alex Dolvin, great job producing. We appreciate your help every week. I did an awesome job of forgetting to plug the fact that in 2 weeks is our major event. The Music Policy Forum Intensive is November 19th and 20th. We're spending 2 days talking about a lot of the issues that we talked about in today's call, but really doing it with a focus on literally how are we doing this work? What does this work look like? Who is, you know, how do you get a job in the next administration if you want to come work in Washington? What's the future of Save Our Stages? I mean, a lot of the stuff, again, that we're talking about here, we're going to be breaking down. So We would love for all of y'all to come join us for as much of those 2 days as you would like to. And there's information on our website about that. With that, questions, concerns, ideas, suggestions, encouragement, you can always hit us up at musicpolicyforum@gmail.com. If you liked today's conversation, the archive will be posted this weekend, and we encourage you to send it to your friends and colleagues. And stay in touch, and everybody stay safe, and everybody get some rest. Have a great rest of your Friday. Thanks, everybody.